So first, I want to thank the ACS Chemical Engineering News for selecting me to be part of this class. I would also like to thank Stuart Schreiber for a very inspiring talk. And today, what I want to focus on telling you is a story about my personal academic journey to academia as a dreamer, and also tell you briefly about our research to untap the potential of iron. Since this is the chemistry symposium, it started with the chemistry between my mom and my dad in 1970. Here they showed a picture of them getting married. Fast forward 13 years later, I was born. I was the eighth child. This is not me. This is actually my youngest daughter. My parents couldn't afford a camera to take a picture of myself. And then Salamanca, Guanajuato is known for having one of the largest petrochemical industries in Mexico. So it has one of the largest refineries. And I wish I could tell you that's why I got inspired to go into chemistry. But unfortunately, in my town, Rancho Los Petos, nobody made it past elementary school. Very few people actually made it past four. So for me, it was never an option to do chemistry. In that end, instead, I focused on becoming a shepherd. But good thing that it never worked out. So I think I have in trouble with this. And it didn't work out. And instead, we immigrated to the United States in 1993. Here's a picture of us as a family shortly thereafter. And I was reaching American soil. I started thinking, dreaming big. What do you want to be when you reach America? And I wanted to be a doctor. And specifically, I wanted to become a neurosurgeon. And I stuck to that goal. And I pushed forward and I started doing landscaping. I was a baker to help the family out. I even considered being a professional boxer for a while. However, midway through my high school, I realized that being undocumented was gonna pose more challenges to being admitted to the university and also paying for the university. So instead, I decided to go and started my own construction business. I was successful at that for a while and barely made it, basically graduated high school, I think with a 1.9 GPA, but enough to get into Sacramento City College. Once I got into City College, I saw this as a new opportunity to restart my American dream. So here we can see that I struggled early on. I got even C's on chemistry, C's on math. But eventually I picked up on the grades. And even before I transferred out of Sacramento City College after 5 years, I even took the MCAT and I scored fairly well. It was above the average. So for me, I was satisfied with this score. All I really needed was to get my bachelor's degree and then some research experience, and I'll be set to go for medical school. And everything changed really when I got into UCLA. Before I went to UCLA, I emailed a lot of different undergraduates, professors there. And one undergraduate in particular, Richard Rodriguez, sent me an email to tell me about Hauk, that he was very good with undergraduates and he was a big deal. And Hauk is a big deal. He's the world's leader expert on using computational tools for a long time to explain organic reactions, selectivity, reactivity, and make predictions that had been validated for a long time. So for me, Hauk became like a father figure. He was a great mentor throughout my time at UCLA, helped me immensely. And also one thing that Hauk gave me was the trust. He trusted me with important projects in organocatalysis and biocatalysis to work with some of the world's leaders on these areas. So we published some examples on this, but this is solidified basically my urge to instead consider a career in chemistry rather than medicine. With that in mind, I went to UC Davis with Professor Tantillo because this was the only school that admitted me for my PhD. Here I focus on a wide range of projects. And one thing that I really have to thank Professor Tantillo for is that he gave me the freedom to pursue any kinds of projects, anything that I was really interested in, rather than assigning one specific project. So I decided to focus on transition metal catalysts, primarily second and third row. And one project that kind of solidified why I wanted to also pursue experiments is the one in the top where I spent a lot of time understanding why certain substrates work and certain substrates did not work in one particular reaction. And then we started designing from computations a new reaction that should work. And we were very happy that Professor Thompson assigned a graduate student that made this complicated substrate, tested out, and in fact, it did work. So that opened up a new area of chemistry. And also for us, it gave us the, I guess personally gave me the confidence that if you're able to combine both the computation and experiment, it could be a very powerful set of skills to do reactions. Some other things happened during UC Davis that really changed my life. And one of them is that President Barack Obama signed a DACA executive action that allowed to apply for a social security and a work permit. So I quickly graduated in a month after and then got my work permit. And 1 month after I was in the East Coast with Professor Kozlowski at Penn doing both computation and experiment. And here we focus on organic and transition metal catalysis, primarily in collaboration with other groups. Well, one project that I was very excited about is the one shown with my picture there, which is one substrate that it took me a while to predict that how this compound will behave under certain palladium conditions. And in fact, it did work. We published that report. And also Kozlowski gave me the opportunity to do grant writing, my own paper writing, teaching even. And during that time, I was kind of getting tired of being on limbo with the whole immigration status. So I decided to take a gamble and apply for the advanced parole. I was granted the advanced parole, and this allowed me to leave the country, but not necessarily return. It was not guaranteed. There was a good chance, but it was never guaranteed. So it was up to the immigration officer. I made it back safely, and then things turned out to be a lot better. I married soon thereafter. I even got a position at the University of Maryland in 2016. Where I started my independent career and focused on using both computational and experimental tools. And as you can see, I started with two students, one graduate student, Wesley, and a postdoc, John Zhu. Midway through my first semester at UMD, my mom passed away after a long battle with cancer, breast cancer. And here's two molecules that really changed her life. One that gave her hope that things were gonna be better and extended her life. And the other one is for those moments where she was in severe pain that she needed to take extra stronger medications to really help with that. And this really brings me to my big picture of the research that we're trying to do. I think we're all familiar with the rising cost of pharmaceuticals, of drugs. I mean, you're talking about $500,000 for a treatment or $80,000 per month for some of the hepatitis C and so on. So it's very expensive. So what can we do with this? So here in the United States, it's very expensive. Now I can only imagine what will happen in third world countries where it's basically considering such options, it's not even an option. So here I want to take a brief minute to tell you about the drug development process and why we think we can make a difference in this area. So everything really starts with making thousands and thousands of compounds, up to 15,000 compounds initially. So you have to have access to those compounds, make them efficiently. So if you're using methods that cost a lot of time and money to make, then that's only going to escalate the price of the drug. And eventually this goes through a whole process where you land into one approval after 12, 15 years. So the average cost for a medicine is about close to $3 billion. And as you can see, the methods they use to construct these molecules, they have to be amenable for small synthesis in the gram scale, for the kilogram scale, and the metric ton scale. And a lot of times the methods that we use as organic chemists, they might work in a small scale, but they might not be amenable for large scale synthesis. So what are the methods that pharmaceuticals use to make? And here, I like to think of this being, here's some representative molecules that people have made where it's in the billion-dollar industry. And you can think of this as being puzzle pieces where using readily accessible building blocks, you can think of those puzzle pieces. Under palladium or nickel catalysis, cross-coupling reactions, they could glue these pieces together. And for that, the Nobel Prize was to recognize the importance for human health. The Nobel Prize was awarded in 2010. And I would like to argue that a lot of this development and why it's really one of the premier methods for making pharmaceuticals is because we understand the details of how these reactions are glued together. So we understand three elementary steps, the oxidative addition, transmetallation, reductive elimination. And we understand, here's shown as a schematic thing, that things working together there, basically the catalyst, the ligand, the solvent, the temperature, they all come together, they all play a critical role in accelerating and controlling each individual step. And if you understand those, then that has led to a large development in new chemistry for palladium cross-coupling reactions and nickel cross-coupling reactions. However, it becomes more problematic when you're trying to make molecules where they deviate from planarity. What about non-planar molecules? For instance, this one here, Taxol. Then using the existing technology that is really set for making two-dimensional structures, three-dimensional structures are becoming a problem. So how would you tackle such a problem like this? And we think that iron can make a difference because iron has been shown to be in particular effective at making things that are not planar, so making sp3 carbon-carbon bonds. And there's been a lot of contributions in the area for a long, long periods of time. However, the main problem with iron is that we don't understand the mechanism, so we don't know how these things are glued together. It's basically a trial and error, and then that becomes a problem because if you're trying to make a drug, you don't want it to think that it might work, it might not work to make the desired carbon-carbon bond. And if it doesn't work, you have no idea of what to tune, what to change in a rational manner to make it work. But if you're able to do that, then we can see that iron versus palladium, it could have profound impact in lowering the medicinal compounds. Here, iron is $300 roughly versus $30,000 per kilogram. It's much more abundant, and it's a lot severely less toxic than palladium. So at the last stage, when you're making these molecules, if you have to spend more money to remove the residual palladium, that becomes a much more expensive process and eventually more expensive drug. So how we're able to do that, we use extensive computational quantum mechanical calculations around centers that are developed across the United States. And we also use organic synthesis in our lab to get insights into how this gluing process with iron works. Because if we understand that, we think we can develop new reactions in a rational manner, we could improve existing reactions, and so on. So here, I started with this example. So I'll just tell you a brief story about one area that we started. Where we started with this example that Nakamura from Kyoto University reported, where you're able to make the desired carbon-carbon bond. And what's kind of nice about this reaction is that first reaction that you're able to selectively build one enantiomer, so one mirror image is the one labeled major. We spent a lot of time, extensive computational time, on studying the mechanism of this transformation. And here, what we identify is four elementary steps. So it's very similar to the catalytic cycle shown before by Joseph and palladium. And here we have four elementary steps, and we identify the key step that is also responsible for giving you the major enantiomer, the major mirror image, rather than the minor. So here you're using this non-covalent interaction, this interaction between the two substrates and the one of the substrates, the one so shown in blue, and the ligand, that those are responsible for controlling the NAND selectivity, so whether you get one mirror image or another. So using this knowledge, we hypothesized that we should be able, in principle, like it's been done with palladium, to develop new transformations in a rational manner rather than trial and error. And that's what we did. We decided that, what about three-component reactions? Can we build three components in a predictive manner? And the answer is yes. We thought that we could basically stop the whole cycle at the radical cage pair. And instead of continuing down as you typically would with a two-component, what if we raise the energy of that, take a detour, and then do a three-component reaction so it wouldn't interact with the green component? And you're able to do that by changing in a rational manner the steric properties of the blue component. So you raise the energy, that interacts with the green in a very predictable manner. That re-enters the calorific cycle. Now you're able to make, rather than one carbon-carbon bond, two carbon-carbon bonds. So I won't go into all the details, but basically from using this kind of technology, we're able to develop two carbon bonds in a 1-5 fashion, in a 1-2 fashion, and also controlling the stereochemistry, so whether you get one mirror or another in the terminating step, and even other radical cascade reactions, for instance, making three different bonds. And so there's a lot more exciting work on this area that we hope to report soon. But here, I'd like to take this also 1 minute to just thank my research group, my collaborators. I didn't get a chance to talk about the nickel catalysis, another area that we're working with. My current students, postdocs, undergraduates, and the ones shown in red are previous undergraduates and postdocs. The funding resources that have supported a lot of the research that's shown in the box. And also my whole family, brothers and sisters. I'm one of 14. And my daughter, my two daughters and my wife, that here's a nice picture of us in my recent U.S. citizenship ceremony. So that kind of closes the catalytic cycle in my side. So I'll be happy to take any questions if anybody. Thank you.
I have one question. Can you talk a little bit about what makes iron such a challenge to model?
What makes iron challenging to model is that iron is known to adapt various different oxidation states. It's very sensitive to also the spin. So little changes, whether even the ligand, is subtle changes to the ligand, whatever it's coordinating, could also change the spin state. And that has, but that complicates things in terms of modeling and also to examine in experiments. So paramagnetic abilities, I guess, in that sense.
All right. Thank you very much.